Hi, everyone. I'm going to present some of our work on climate change monitoring. Climate change strongly affects the polar regions, but it also strongly affects the alpine areas, such as the Swiss Alps. Most of you know that glaciers are melting and retreating, but it is less known that a large fraction of the alpine region is actually permafrost. Permafrost is ground that is most of the time frozen throughout the year, and it can be rock or soil. And this ground is thawing, which leads to an increasing risk of slope instabilities, leading to rock falls and landslides. And one big major rock fall occurred a few years ago in Switzerland. And now I need a bit of your imagination, because this black rectangle is a video, and it shows a massive rock fall where a whole mountain face crashes down. And if you pictured it right, it looked something like this. These rock falls lead to fatalities and have major impact on infrastructure and the economy. So how can we face these challenges? On the one hand, we need to find measures to mitigate the impact. In our case, this means how can we prevent that such a rock fall turns into a disaster? On the other hand, we need to understand the underlying processes in order to be better prepared in the future. So for our scenario, this means to understand which geophysical processes leads to a rock fall. In order to answer this question, we have deployed an environmental monitoring setup in the high alpine region of southern Switzerland. To be more specific, at the edge of the cloud. Our group installed and maintains a wireless sensor network at 3,500 meters at the Hörnligrad on Matterhorn. And this is part of a bigger project called Permasense, which is an ongoing group effort by many researchers, which has evolved for more than a decade. In the following, I would like to highlight some of the projects I've been involved with. So our group is mainly focusing on technology. So how can we use technology to answer the previous mentioned questions? These questions are somehow related, but are conceptually different. So one relates to the concept of natural hazard warning, and the other to fundamental research. I would like to show you how we use two other concept pairs to address the challenges that come with these questions. These concept pairs are namely edge computing and cloud computing, and expert knowledge and machine learning. So for a natural hazard warning requires fast response time, high accuracy in the moment of the hazard, and a high reliability. Fundamental research, on the other hand, requires sound reasoning, long-term analysis, and the development of a model to explain the process to be described. But let me give you a concrete example. In our field deployment, we've installed so-called geophones. These sensors measure the ground vibration. And for fundamental research, this can be used to analyze how the mountain slope reacts to the continuous freeze and thaw cycles. So this requires long-term measurements. In hazard warning, we need to know how and how fast we can detect an imminent rockfall. But there's a big issue with these sensors, as they're strongly impacted by external influences. One example at our location is mountaineers who are climbing close to the sensors. Depicted in blue here, you see the activity recorded with the geophone over 2 years, and above in orange, you see the number of overnight stays at the nearby hut. We have found a strong correlation of overnight stays and activity, so apparently mountaineers distort our signal. So it's quite clear that we need to remove the mountaineers for a good analysis and for a reliable hazard warning system. But there are also other advantages of knowing if a mountaineer is present. For example, in case of emergency, we would want to know and inform the local authorities about how many persons are in the danger zone. So we designed a mountaineer classifier using a convolutional neural network and trained it on a custom data set based on our geophone data. The classifier worked quite well on our test set, but the actual question is how good and how do we compute it in a real deployment? We have basically two options. So either compute it on the edge or compute it in the cloud. On the edge, we have a very fast response time, but are limited by energy, processing power, and memory. In the cloud, an additional delay is introduced, but we basically have no resource constraints. In order to understand the challenges in computing the classifier on the edge, let's first have a look at how this convolutional neural network is actually computed. This is a very simplified illustration, and it receives a time frequency representation of our geophone data as an input, and then this is processed by multiple layers, and finally it results in an output, which in our case is the probability of a mountaineer being present or not. So in the cloud, traditionally, the CNN is computed layer by layer. So the input flows through the layer, and everything is computed per layer. This is well optimized in modern frameworks. So we can easily classify the mountaineers present in our signal. And the black line here shows our the signal with the mountaineers removed. But can we use the same model on the edge? So we actually run into problems if we try to run it on the edge, because the layer-by-layer computation produces large intermediate results which do not fit in the memory of our edge device. However, when we analyze the processing, we discover that the intermediate results are actually only affected by a fraction of the input. So we can take advantage of this and effectively subdivide the whole input into multiple chunks and start computing as soon as the first chunk arrives, and then just continuously update and buffer our memory. And this requires a sophisticated buffering system, which we call time-distributed processing. And this makes it, us be able to compute everything on our resource-limited devices. We've implemented both methods and used them where appropriate. So on the edge, we use time-distributed processing in a prototype of a natural hazard warning system. And in the cloud, we use the Mountaineer classifier to improve long-term analysis. We made everything open source and published this last year. But the question is, how do we decide which external influence should be removed from a signal and which should be kept? So should we hire a domain expert, or can we use novel machine learning techniques? The expert might be comprehensible, but we cannot scale their work to increasing data volumes, which can be done with machine learning approaches. However, we might not understand how the decision was being made. We propose again to use the best of both worlds. Use the expert to inject knowledge into the system, which in return provides relevant data for the expert. Concretely, we are developing and currently testing an interactive online analysis tool and use it to engage with domain experts. One of such collaboration was a recent hackathon we hosted in collaboration with Microsoft and their AI for Earth program. In addition, we are looking at unsupervised learning techniques to discover more information in our data. This is ongoing work, and I'm happy to discuss everything after the talk. So let's summarize. I've shown you two ways of two concepts of addressing climate change challenges, introduced ways of using edge and cloud computing for these tasks, and presented ongoing work on how to integrate machine learning and expert knowledge. This concludes my talk. If you want to have a look at the video, just go to that link hidden behind the QR code, and there you also find more information. And there's also a poster in the poster session where you can actually find me and talk to me. Thank you.
Questions?
I have a question. How did you install the sensors?
Who's the mountain? You basically find the nicest mountain that there is in Switzerland, and then you climb up there and drill in, some holes with these huge drills, and then you install them. So, basically, one of our team members is a qualified guide for, like a mountaineer guide, and he basically started everything and installed these sensors. You, of course, need permissions and everything, but yeah.
It's time for another quick question, maybe here.
Thanks for the talk. So, you show in the time series that you have this perturbation because of the mountaineers. Is this the only perturbation that you saw, or?
No, so in this work, we're actually looking at more influences. It's not just the mountaineers, but this is just the example for this talk. And you need to extend it. That's why we also try to introduce this feedback knowledge loop, because there's a lot which we do not understand and which we cannot see on the other sensors. Mountaineers was easy, because we have images of the location and everybody's able to say this is a person or not. But if you're looking at other influences which are not that easy to interpret, it's getting harder. So we sort of need some unsupervised methods to find more information.
Thanks again, Matthias.